This episode of TechZilla is brought to you by Ting. Time to get our AC Nation on. We're going to talk home theater in a box. You've been asking for reviews and why folks are up in arms with The Hobbit being shot in 48 frames per second. But right now, let's start with LG's home theater system, literally a Blu-ray home theater in a box. Mr. Heron, let's hear the details.
Hey, we're taking a look today at the LG BH9420PW. It's a $700, roughly speaking, 5.1 speaker system, complete with Blu-ray player built in. Two-port HDMI switch in the back, a whole bunch of applications you can load up, and pretty good audio quality right out of the box. I'd say I would describe it as warm and rich sounding. Dynamic range compression is enabled by default. That helps with the voices, as is the system's 3D sound system that is automatically enabled during the playback of 3D movies. Now, that 3D system being a separately wired speaker that's actually up-firing, that adds a little, I'd say, dimensionality. It increases it with your,
it's like
with your 3D Blu-ray playback.
Those speakers in the 70s, where they were basically aiming tweeters in different directions to sort of bounce it off all corners of the room.
Totally.
That sounds gimmicky to me.
A little, but I would say it's nice having just an additional driven speaker in each of the loudspeakers that were there. Also, I mentioned a very good center channel. The voices, as you hear them from your favorite shows and movies, were very discernible with that default setup. Purists, if you want to bypass things like dynamic range compression and 3D sound, there's a button right on the remote control that allows you to bypass those, quote, wacky audio enhancements, if you want to get rid of that. Wireless rear speakers that are included as addition. You're holding both the receiver as well as one of the wireless rear channels. It's RF technology, unlike some IR systems I've used in the past, so you can walk in front of the receiver and it's not going to block the signal.
So basically, this goes somewhere in the back of the room and I run wires from this to my wireless rear speakers.
That's exactly how it works. And there's also mounts too for the rear speakers if you find a set of stands that you would like to use with them. But it doesn't include rear stands. So that was one thing I kind of missed right out of the box.
It's got the generic, you know, nail in the wall or
there you go.
Traditional bolt mount. It was funny, what's going on with this?
That's a custom cable for a couple of reasons. One, they're wiring two sets of speakers, number one. But also, it just makes setup a little easier, color-coded, although on the back there it's not color-coded, but on the back of the receiver it is. So it's just one of those things to help make it a little easier to do. But if you want to lengthen these cables, you're going to have to do some custom work if you want to try to do that yourself.
What was your big problem with this machine?
I'd say with most of the home theater gear I look at nowadays, they all include a calibration microphone that will help not only verify your speaker setup, but also balance things like audio volume and timing of the speakers. Mm-hmm. This doesn't include one, and that's a pretty basic feature I'm finding even on entry-level products nowadays. Also, the HDMI switch built into this system is not automatic switching, and switching between the HDMI ports is cumbersome. I got it down to only four button presses on the remote to go from HDMI 2 to HDMI 1.
What?
Yeah.
There's no Blu-ray button, there's no...
There's a menu of items that you can dive into to try to go directly to devices, but that if you're planning on doing a lot of switching between HDMI 1 and 2, it's kind of a pain, and I'd probably think about maybe going universal on it to try to correct that. Also, I ran into an occasional but rare HDMI issue, usually with handshaking where you get the snow-covered screen until you shake it out and get things working right. And it would have been nice if LG would have sent this product through some sort of HDMI verification to make sure that the ports are 100%. It's not an issue everyone's gonna run into, but I did, and it's kind of annoying when you do. Even better?
The pause and the fuzz.
Exactly. HDMI should not be a problem at this point. There's plenty of good test tools out there to make sure it's working straight. Also, there's a company called Silicon Image that's related that they could have even made this a one better product by making the HDMI ports a little more usable. Instead of having labels HDMI 1, 2, and so on, they could have actually had a preview of what is connected to that port, making it a little more intuitive, perhaps. Or also, they have a technology called InstaPort, which would have made switching between the HDMI ports less of a hassle. Anyway, just stuff I could think of to fix it. Also, if you're using the HDMI ports in the back, you're not getting any lossless multi-channel audio decoding.
Really?
Yeah, so if you're gonna hook your PlayStation 3 up to this and you're expecting to see the laundry list of supported audio formats, ain't gonna happen. You're gonna get the basics of DTS and Dolby, in addition to a couple of stereo LPCM formats as well.
That's fine for the average user, but audio enthusiasts are gonna be irked.
If you're looking to drive additional products that do incorporate high-end audio output, this ain't the product for you. Also, Blu-ray playback. This is a pretty basic Blu-ray player built into this. Basic video processing. The Samsung ES8000, that TV we showed you a couple weeks ago, its video processor will run circles around in the LG disc player. However, for most of your videos you're gonna be looking at either in the Blu-ray format or in the DVD format, you're probably not going to run into too many issues. However, if you're into watching certain types of anime or TV shows that are encoded in a video format and not a movie film style format, you might see some loss of detail with a player like this.
Premium apps, at least.
Premium apps, though, and they work pretty well. LG also has their standard apps as well. I honestly ignore the standard apps on this. It's a throwback to cell phone apps I saw a decade ago. But your premium apps are things you would expect, like your Netflix, Pandora, Hulu, and so on. Also, Bluetooth is built into this device, so you're able to link your smartphone to it and do audio streaming.
Cool.
I was also able to plug in a USB cable to the front of it and plug my phone in that way and stream audio as well. No video streaming directly from my mobile devices. Also, you have Wi-Fi built in, which is nice. DLNA support if you're streaming your content around the house. Audio return channel if you're using that feature from your TV. You're using the apps built into your TV. The audio return channel over HDMI will bring that audio back into this. It's a pretty common feature you're seeing nowadays. And in general, I was just overall pretty good, I would say. The 5.1 speaker setup and all, I keep thinking, though, that if this were me, I would probably want to build out separate components.
This seems expensive for what you get. If this was $300, it would be like, hey,
be
don't
no-brainer.
Worry about the HDMI problems, or don't worry about it. For $700, though, it seems a little steep.
Totally. If you go online today, you can find a nice AV receiver starting at about $180, $160, $180. You could also find a good set of speakers for about the same price. And then you add in your Blu-ray player, or maybe you already have a Blu-ray player. This system's really set up for folks who have nothing but the TV at this point. And you need a decent set of speakers, and the apps would be an additional bonus for you. Mm-hmm. And your needs as far as plugging in additional components, probably not so much. But for other people who are looking for more of an all-in-one unit to basically plug in any device you want and receive full audio support, perhaps slightly better video support, there are other options for you to look at.
We've actually got one coming in from Denon for review in the next few weeks.
I guarantee I'll be getting that in very soon.
Did I mention follow-ups to The Lord of the Rings, the furry-footed creatures that make Mr. Heron so angry? Jeff writes in, I'm curious to hear your reactions regarding Peter Jackson showing off a bit of The Hobbit shot at 48 frames per second. The reporters who watched the footage complained of 48 frames per second being too clear, too sharp, which is basically the soap opera effect on a huge screen. I know the film wasn't finished, and it's been shot in native 3D, but I'm a huge movie fanatic who's now skeptical of this new technological advancement in film. Will it ruin the experience seeing movies now so crystal clear that you can spot the visual effects and other filmmaking secrets? Will it ruin the overall magic, or will we just have to get used to everything being shot at higher frame rates in the future? I'm sure the 3D at 48 frames per second is amazing. My fingers are crossed. Jeff in Anaheim, California.
Very cool. I personally, I see it as just another toolbox for the director and the cinematographer to use when they're recording the content that they're recording. If they wanted to create a film-like 24 FPS look out of that 48 hertz content, it's going to be easy to do. Mm-hmm. And likewise, if they're actually creating 3D content like they are in this case for The Hobbit, it's going to give them, hopefully, additional clarity and additional brightness in the final produced work. Of course, we haven't actually seen any finished project yet using 48 frames per second. So I'm hoping this will be the first one. I'm going to reserve judgment until I actually see the finished work and how the artist actually puts it together.
Yeah, Peter Jackson's a pretty amazing. The dude's an unbelievably talented director. I mean, Lord of the Rings is fantastic. I'm with Heron. Wait till it's done, and then if we want to savage it, do it then. But the other thing is, like, technology is advancing. Directors, you know, especially at sort of the high end of tech, more technologically sophisticated, non-traditionalists, are really, really wanting to push how they shoot digitally. And 48 frames per second is one of the ways it's going to happen. And it may change the look of feel, because the look, the feel of film that we all get so, you know, when we see that shiny, you know, there's no stutter to it, that's because we're not watching 100-year-old technology. We're watching contemporary technology. And that's a battle that's going to shake down in Hollywood, I think.
Totally. And there's a lot of, there's additional technology being used on this project, The Hobbit I'm speaking of specifically. These very high-resolution digital cameras, they're incorporating the faster frame rate. I'm just looking forward to see what they do with this. And even in the projection system, when you go to the theater, how are they going to deal with a 48 hertz signal? Are they going to just frame double it to, you know,
just 96 hertz? Just because they shot it in 48 hertz.
Or are they going to triple that?
Doesn't
a lot
mean
of cool
it's
stuff
going
to
be displayed in 48 hertz.
Yes. I think we should take a little time to thank one of our sponsors.
It's amazing, right? It's a bunch of geeks. They get really irritated with cell phone companies. So they came up with a new service called Ting. The idea is that they're going to make it really easy to use and not get ripped off by your phone company. Big savings for mobile phone users. Ting has a really simple plan that offers fair, honest pricing. Megabytes, minutes, text messages. You basically, you go to the Ting website. you tell them how many megabytes you usually use, how many minutes you usually use, how many text messages you usually use, and they're billed separately. You use more, and you pay a little bit more for the next tier. You use less, and you pay less. It's incredible, right? You get a credit if you pay more. So you can basically jam all the meters down to the minimum, use as much cell phone or data as you like, and you don't get ripped off. There's no giant, massive smack on the back of your head because you actually used your cell phone. No BS either. Now, for the month of May, Ting is going to take things a step further with their Dump Your Contract promotion. I like this. Every single day in May, Ting's going to buy one lucky winner out of his or her mobile service contract. Ting will pay up to $300 in early termination fees in order to help would-be Ting users get out of their cruddy contract and discover a new way of doing mobile. Cruise on over to ting.com/DYC to enter. And by the way, you should check out the online savings calculator at techzilla.ting.com. And if you're ready to get started, you'll get $50 off your device purchase just for being a Techzilla viewer. That's the deal, right? You buy your hardware, you get incredible deals on the service, you save mad money. Techzilla.ting.com. And don't forget to enter the Dump Your Contract sweepstakes at ting.com/DYC. This is really sweet, people. You should go check it out.